It is now time for our question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Speaker, my question to the Acting Premier. Acting Premier, every morning when I wake up, I ask myself a question. What can we do to create more jobs, more opportunities with better take-home pay for Ontarians, those who are out of work and those who are struggling to get by in a part-time job? And on this side of the House, we believe that the first step towards providing a more prosperous province of Ontario with better jobs is to balance the books, to spend with our means, not to put more debt on the back of the next generation. We're concerned that you're going in the opposite direction, that you have a belief on that side of the House that you're going to try to spend your way out of deficit. I have a documents here that my colleague Mr. Fidelli from Nipissing found called Fiscal Plan Information. It appears to be a cabinet briefing of February 13, 2013. Which indicates that the Liberal plan to balance a budget, according to finance officials, is a sham. Was the minister on this document?
You see it, please. You see it, please. Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Well, thank you, Speaker. And before I respond to the question, I do want to extend my condolences to the family of Herb Gray. For four decades, Herb Gray dedicated his life to public service. He served as a minister under three prime ministers, deputy prime minister himself, and on behalf of the Liberal caucus, and I think all members of this House, we extend our condolences to the family of Herb Gray. Speaker, to the question, I mean, this is a clear division between the Conservative Party and the Liberal Party. The Conservative Party thinks that they can cut their way to prosperity. On this side, we believe in investing in people. We believe in investing in infrastructure, Speaker. We've seen this before. We've seen this before, and let's just remind ourselves how many jobs were lost the last time they had the opportunity to do that.
Thank you.
Speaker, it's not just how much.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, thank you, Speaker. Of course, we echo condolences to the family of Herb Gray, a great Canadian, a great public official. We also extend our condolences to the family of Kim Fletcher, who sadly, Speaker, passed away. And my colleague, Mr. Chudley, my health critic, Christine Elliott, we're fighting hard for Mrs. Fletcher. I'm going to pass on through one of the pages, if I could, the document, Minister, that you would have been briefed on. Again, it's confidential advice to Cabinet from February 13th. I refer you to page 9. Page 9 in this document indicates that you have no plan to balance the budget. The numbers are no more than a fiction. Page 9 also will tell you that the finance officials, it's not us, not Mr. Fidelli, though he would have told you the same thing, indicate it was going to take potentially another 6 years to balance the budget. Could the minister confirm that is actually your plan, another
Question.
6 years to balance our budget?
Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Speaker, if the member, leader of the opposition, is sincere when he says he wakes up every morning wondering how he can create more jobs, he's demonstrating that in a pretty bizarre way, because his promises, he wants to fire 10,000 education workers, gone. Fire 2,000 healthcare workers, gone. He wants to cancel full-day kindergarten. He wants to end the 30% tuition grant. He doesn't want to move forward with the investments we're making for children or people with developmental disabilities. He wants to cancel job-creating partnerships. For example, Open Text, 1,200 jobs, Speaker. The member, or the leader of the opposition, his jobs plan is to kill jobs. Our jobs plan is to invest in jobs. We are on track to balance, Speaker, but we will not do that at the expense of the people of Ontario.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
I know the page bringing over the minister. I think I've been absolutely clear each and every day. I've got a plan to create 1 million good jobs in the province of Ontario. If the minister wants to know more about my plan, I'm glad to send a copy across the way. Again, Speaker, I think I've been very clear. Now, the concern I have is that the minister has been briefed. The Premier, the Finance Minister, had these documents over a year ago. You buried them. Mr. Fidelli, the member for Nipissing, has done a good job at uncovering them. This is serious advice from finance officials that have said that you have no plan to balance. And in fact, we're risking another 6 years. This is finance officials that briefed you, the Premier, the Finance Minister. And I worry that when you're using these types of fiscal sleights of hand, these card tricks, that undermines confidence in our province.
Question.
People are watching, job creators, investors. Minister, if you have no plan to create jobs in the province of Ontario but put us farther in debt, isn't it time to change a team that leads this province?
Yeah. 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 Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Well, Speaker, people won't need a great memory to remember that the last time they had the chance, Speaker, they actually hid the deficit from the people of this province.
Yes.
$5.6 billion. That deficit was hidden from the people of this province. So we are going to deliver a budget on Thursday. It will be a budget that invests in people, that invests in prosperity, invests in infrastructure. Speaker, the party opposite last time filled in the hole for the Eglinton Crosstown Subway. I just hope they're not planning to halt production at the Cambridge Memorial Hospital.
Thank you. One question. The Leader of the Opposition.
You know, it is telling, Speaker, when the Deputy Premier won't even come close to answering a very direct question. She won't acknowledge if she was briefed on this document as the Premier and the Finance Minister, where I suspect you were. It is a confidence in Cabinet document that we've now made public. I'm going to refer the Deputy Premier to page 5 of the document that she read at least last year, if not more recently. Page 5, also from finance officials, it indicates that the economy has still not yet regained the strength of 2008. There are fewer jobs relative to population and more unemployed in our province, and per capita output of the economy remains below the pre-recession level. Now, when I hear the Premier, the Finance Minister, they say the opposite. Quite frankly, Speaker, based on this track record, the gas plant scandal, I believe the finance officials. I think they're on the money here.
Question.
The problem is you're ignoring them. Do you agree or disagree with the Ministry of Finance officials that we're still behind where we were as recently as 2008?
Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Speaker, we are on target to balance, and what I can tell you is that we have implemented...
That's enough. Minister? Carry on.
Speaker, we're moving forward with 80% of Don Drummond's recommendations. We're the first government since 1996 to actually reduce spending. We've got the leanest government in the country, Speaker, with the lowest program spending.
The member from Bruce Gray, Owen Sound, come to order.
As I said, there is a stark difference between their plan and our plan. For them, the whole plan is balance the books as quickly as possible.
And for Nipissing Pembroke.
To the people of this province. We are committed to investing in people.
Answer.
We are committed to making those investments that will create a prosperous economy for all people.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, I'll point out a very stark difference. The minister uses that term. Minister, as you know, every province and the federal government will be in balance before the province of Ontario. Six of those provinces and the federal government are already there. That talk about a stark difference. We all were hit by the same international circumstances in 2008, but everybody else is back on track. Another stark difference? We will balance the budget to pave the way for job creation and put people back to work in the province of Ontario. We're going to spend it to bankruptcy. Let me make this point. Again, these are finance officials that are pointing out that your job numbers are not even above where we were 6 years ago. 6 years ago, going backwards. So tell me who's right and who's wrong. The finance minister and the premier say one thing. The finance officials say the opposite. My money is on the objective advice of senior civil servants. Why aren't you putting the facts on the table?
Question.
Why won't you admit they're right, you're wrong, it's time for new leaders.
Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Speaker, I think that it's very important that the people in this province understand what's at stake. The Leader of the Opposition has made it very clear his only priority is to get to deficit. I can only assume that means he will halt the infrastructure projects that are moving forward, including Cambridge Memorial Hospital. Speaker, I can only assume that means he will not support increased support for families caring for people with developmental disabilities. Speaker, we are moving forward with a plan that creates a bright future for the people of this province. We are not going to accept the slash and burn, get to balance, take it, right to work for less attitude of that party, Speaker.
Answer.
It's not the right way forward, and we will continue to do what we know needs to be
done.
Thank
you. Final supplementary.
Well, it's true. I have a plan to put 1 million people back to work in the province of Ontario with less debt, affordable hydro, and lower taxes. It's a plan that's going to work. And I'm ready to put that before taxpayers to decide if they want to stay on the current path or forge boldly forward a more prosperous province. Let me make one last point on the document that you were briefed upon. I think what's important in the document to advise the cabinet, fiscal plan information, was that it ties the lack of job creation with the fact that you're increasing debt in the province of Ontario. And it's an important economic lesson that the Liberal Party seems to miss. We just fundamentally believe that if you spend within your means, just like families do every day, you send a signal of confidence that Ontario is a place to be. And make no mistake, we are bound and determined to put less debt on the back of the next generation and more jobs on the back of prosperity. That is a clear difference. We understand that. We say, let's get on with it. Why won't you?
Thank you. Be seated, please. Thank you. Deputy Premier.
Speaker, with respect, the Leader of the Opposition doesn't have a plan. What he has is a soundbite.
Yeah.
And anyone who has looked at the plan is very quickly discovers it is no plan at all, Speaker. It is a soundbite and only a soundbite. Let me repeat. The jobs that he's already committed to cutting, 10,000 education workers, 2,000 healthcare workers,
the member from Hamilton East, Stoney Creek,
tuition grant. He's not supporting families with developmental disabilities, Speaker. And I'm just curious about whether canceling the expansion of Joe Brand Hospital is in your plan as well.
Thank you. New question. The member from Windsor-Tecumseh.
Thank you, Speaker. My question this morning is to the Minister of Transportation and Infrastructure. Good morning, Minister. Thank you for acknowledging the birth of my granddaughter, Katana. Yeah. Speaker, the Minister has said... Speaker, the Minister has said that as soon as he found out that the girders on the Herb Gray Parkway were faulted, he acted immediately. Does the Minister still stand by that statement?
Thank you. Minister of Transportation and Infrastructure.
Yes, Mr. Speaker. It's interesting that the gentleman opposite put out a statement, but he left one page out of all the documents he released. He neglected to share with the media this one note. Although the note reflects that the minister's office staff were present in meetings, it should be noted that discussions at those meetings focused on project milestones and evolving issues related to the project agreement. There was not sufficient information during the time periods referenced in the note to make definitive recommendations to the minister or his staff regarding the safety and durability of the girders. Further, the minister's office staff were briefed on the safety and durability issues regarding girders of the Herb Gray Parkway on June 14, 2013, and the minister briefed on June 19, 2013 for the first time, Mr. Speaker. That's the piece of paper you kind of forgot. The other reason is, Mr. Speaker, I actually heard about this outside of government in the month previous, and when I researched it, I addressed this with my deputy minister the first week of June, which is when she organized the review and discovered the problem.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, according to documents released through a Freedom of Information request, both the offices of the Premier and the Minister knew that girders were not up to code and posed a threat to safety before they were installed. The Minister's office learned about the substandard girders in December of 2012.
Wow.
High-level bi-weekly meetings were held afterwards to discuss them. The meetings included senior staff within the minister's office, and as early as in April, the executive director of policy in the premier's office was sent the minutes of these meetings. Is the minister saying that senior staff in his own office The same people, the same senior staff of Minister Schiarelli held the phone.
Question?
Did not tell him about public safety concerns on the largest infrastructure project in Ontario's history.
Thank you.
That he's responsible for.
Thank you. Minister?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm saying even more than that. Not only is that wrong, Mr. Speaker, it was my office that first heard of the problem from people outside of government. When I went to my deputy minister the first week of June, she told me she was unaware of the problem, as was the deputy minister of infrastructure. It never actually landed. As a result of my inquiries, Mr. Speaker, a briefing was held for my staff on the 14th. I'll even go further for the honourable member. If you actually go through the paperwork, you will find that the public administration was divided about whether there was a safety issue until late August, when I ordered independent destructive testing and it was revealed that one of the girders was faulty. That was the last week of August,
yes,
Mr. Speaker. There's your paper trail. If you want to tell the whole paper trail, then I think just
Thank
for
you.
Integrity reasons, you would release all the information, Mr. Speaker.
Final supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Again to the minister. We know that senior advisors from the minister's office were in meetings that discussed the problem of girders, and that senior advisors in the premier's office were being sent minutes of the biweekly girder meetings as early as in April, and possibly even earlier. Does the minister expect people of this province to believe that senior advisors or the premier's senior advisors didn't alert him to a potential scandal surrounding faulty girders being installed on this project?
Thank you, Minister.
So, Mr. Speaker, I have respect for the member opposite, and I think the truth matters, Mr. Speaker. The note, which I have here, Mr. Speaker, and I will gladly send over it to him, clearly and explicitly says that any discussions prior to June 14th were not about safety issues. They were about commercial applications of the project and had nothing to do with safety issues, and the member knows that. The member also knows that it wasn't until the last week of August that there was even a consensus amongst public officials that there in fact was a safety problem, and it wasn't until I ordered independent testing in late July that resulted in the girders being destroyed that we actually discovered that. My question, Mr. Speaker, is where was the opposition? I was doing your job. The member from Windsor West, Mr. Speaker, raised this issue before, and it sounds like the member for Tecumseh is trying to play catch-up, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question. Yeah, member from.
Thank you, Speaker.
I got it.
The
member from Tecumseh Windsor.
Ah, thank you. Somebody's got to do the job of the government. Speaker, in a July 21, 2013 confidential memo to the Premier on the girder issue, it states, and I quote, "There has been some chatter about this situation in Windsor construction circles, and we understand the Windsor Star may be coming out with a story on this matter this week. It may break during the Premier's visit to Windsor on July 22nd, end of quotes. Minister, why did this government fail to take action for months on public safety and allow the faulty girders to be installed, and only acted when a scandal was about to break that could put five Liberal seats at risk in impending by-elections?
Minister.
Thank you. I'm going to try this again really slowly, Mr. Speaker. The paper trail is very clear, as are the discussions. There were active conversations about this project and any other. To be very clear, there was no discussion, not a word iota of discussion of safety issues or briefings until June 19th with politicians, because I was the first one. The reason those discussions happened is because I heard rumors in May that there may be a problem. I did not hear those rumors inside government. I heard it from meeting with stakeholder groups who asked me to investigate. The first week of June, I went to my deputy ministers, both of them, and asked them if they knew anything. They both said, clearly that they were not aware of any particular safety concerns. Both of them undertook a review, and 2 weeks later, I was briefed that the things I had heard may have merit. Finally, Mr. Speaker, we had an independent review which tried to decide whether or not those safety issues were consequential, and that was very public, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. We know from internal correspondence that this government didn't act on public safety concerns for 7 months after it knew girders on the Herb Gray Parkway were faulty. This government only acted after political staff found out that the Windsor Star was asking questions about girder safety, and the Premier might be confronted with a question on her scheduled visit to Windsor. Had the Windsor Star not been investigating these girders, would these unsafe girders continue to be quietly installed to this very day?
Minister.
So, Mr. Speaker, you know, there is, both of us come from a municipal background. In a municipal background, you do not attribute motive. As a matter of fact, you're thrown out of a council chamber for attributing motive. So, I'll just say,
that'll do.
I had almost no weekends away with my family through this period of time because I was working on this through the entire summer. Mr. Speaker, as late as August, senior officials were not convinced that there were safety concerns, including the engineering. It was only when we did the destructive testing. But, Mr. Speaker, the member has the note from the officials that he did not release that tells the public that what you're saying is so inaccurate it bears no resemblance to the actual events, Mr. Speaker. So if you want to read this document where the officials say prior to June there was no, zero, not a word of discussion about
safety. Member from Nookie and Carleton will come to order, and now we'll hear new question. Oh, sorry, final supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. The Premier, when she was the Minister of Transportation, awarded the project agreement for the Windsor-Essex Parkway through alternate financing procurement, a fancy name for privatizing public projects. According to internal documents, this government prioritized the Premier's contract with a private consortium over the ability for MTO to enforce public safety rules. Why did this government set up a project agreement that threatened public safety?
Minister.
It is, first, patently inaccurate. I don't want to use unparliamentary language, but there's another word that's floating around in my head, Mr. Speaker.
Don't use it, Glenn.
The reality is there were absolutely no concerns around safety through that particular period of time. The first person to raise a safety issue at the ministerial level was myself, based on concerns that were given. I will not read into the record again the bureaucrat note, the official's note on this. Mr. Speaker, the member has been given a full and honest answer. I've always respected him as a person with integrity. I would like to point out that all of the documentation shows that the first safety discussion with me was on June 19th, and I took more than strong action and more than immediately, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question, the member from the
Speaker, my question is to the acting premier. This week, the Gas Plants Committee, Injustice Committee, has the opportunity to sit on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday morning. We have requested that the former government House leader and the former transition chair to Premier Wynne testify. Monique Smith, however, is unwilling to do that, and we are experiencing very much difficulty trying to have her come into the committee.
Order.
Let me be very clear. Let me be very clear. The former government House leader would have known about Peter Feist's contract with the Liberal Caucus Bureau, and Peter Wallace said and testified under oath that Monique Smith, as the transition team chair, would have known about the gas plant emails and passwords. So, given that she is a crucial piece of the gas plant puzzle, will you compel Monique Smith to testify? You've got her appointed to a government job.
Thank you.
Bring her back to Ontario and have
things. Order. The member from Cambridge will come to order. Before we proceed, it's always helpful to address your questions to the Speaker. Deputy Premier.
House Leader.
The member from Prince Edward Hastings will come to order. Government House Leader.
Speaker, the Honourable Member is wrong. Ms. Smith was asked to appear in front of the committee. She has agreed to appear in front of the committee. She has given several dates to the clerk, and I am advised, in fact, that she's able to attend the week of May 5th or May 12th have been two timelines that she has been given. I think members would appreciate that Ms. Smith is actually located in Washington, D.C., and has to make travel arrangements. And, Mr. Speaker, I would remind the honourable member that we asked the Leader of the Opposition to appear in front of the committee. It went on for week after week after week after week, and he's in the same building, Mr. Speaker. And when it comes to the Conservative candidates, Mr. Speaker.
The Minister from Rural Affairs is not being helpful. The member from Leeds-Grenville is not helpful. The member from Kitchener-Conestoga is not helpful. And the member from Chatham-Kent-Essex is not helpful. You did just did. Carry on.
Speaker, when it comes to the Conservative candidates, the same ones that said elect us and we'll get rid of the gas plant, Mr. Speaker, we're still waiting on them. In fact, we've asked one of them, Mr. Speaker, over 16 times to appear.
Supplementary.
Well, I would like to remind the government House Leader, it is his party under an OPP investigation, not mine. It was their former House Leader and their former transition team chair that was responsible for dealing with the gas plant scandal during a certain period of time, not the Leader of the official opposition. And it is his party that sent Monique Smith to Washington during the OPP investigation and the search and seizure warrant, where she is outside the Speaker's jurisdiction for a Speaker's warrant. I ask him again. We are sitting this week. Monique Smith is key and pivotal to getting the answers that the committee needs in order to complete its work. Will you compel her on her government job to come back to Ontario this week and appear before the committee on Thursday morning, yes or no?
Thank you. Government House Leader.
Again, Mr. Speaker, the honourable member is wrong.
That'll just be the end of it. You ask the question, listen to the answer. The Minister of Aboriginal Affairs is not helpful. The member from Renfrew-Nipissing, Pembroke, second time. Carry on.
Mr. Speaker, the honourable member is wrong. She did not recant. She stood up and said, "Ms. Smith will not appear in front of the committee." She will appear in front of the committee. She is travelling related to her job, a very important job, Mr. Speaker, and she is given a series of dates over the next several weeks. In fact, when she will appear in front of the committee, where she is also wrong, Mr. Speaker, is when she notes Peter Wallace in his testimony. In fact, what Mr. Wallace said is that he did not brief the transition team on this matter, Mr. Speaker. So two strikes, Mr. Speaker, and I think she's out. But again, Mr. Speaker, we are looking for the PC candidates to come forward, Mr. Speaker. We are looking for them to explain their policy analysis and their costing.
Thank you. New question? The member from London West.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Transportation and Infrastructure. Despite the Minister's office knowing the safety risks, the Minister of Transportation and Infrastructure allowed faulty girders to be installed and construction to proceed for months, and only took action to halt construction on July 21, 2013. My question is this. What prompted the Minister to take action in July?
Minister of Infrastructure and Transportation.
Mr. Speaker, what prompted me to take action was when I became minister, which was only a couple of months before that, I invited all of the stakeholders into my office. I started meeting with all of the construction parties in Windsor and London and Ottawa, and I asked them each. And Mr. Speaker, you always hear people raising concerns. All the people who didn't get the contracts complain about the people who did. So you have to take a lot of what you hear with a grain of salt. But what I did start hearing, Mr. Speaker, was repeated concerns about the process and the installation of girders. When I validated that that was in fact a concern that had some legitimacy and was different than the background noise one hears about in the construction industry, I called in the CEOs of four different construction companies and asked them for their advice. Based on the advice of different individuals, Mr. Speaker, I went to my deputy minister the first week of June. Both deputy ministers said they had not heard of any safety concerns, nor had staff raised them with them. Based on that, I asked them to investigate, Mr. Speaker. That's what happened.
Supplementary.
Speaker, the minister's office knew by December of 2012 that girders to be installed were not up to safety standards. During a February 14, 2013 meeting in the minister's office, girders were on the agenda, and the minister's office staff confirmed that they would not be intervening or speaking to the issue directly. The minister says he didn't find out about the girder safety issue until May 2013. Is the minister saying that senior staff in his own office, who knew about girder safety concerns for months, never spoke to him about it at all?
Thank you, Minister.
I am saying much more than that, Mr. Speaker. I'm saying they did not know about it. The deputy ministers in infrastructure and the deputy ministers in transportation both did not know about it. A matter of fact, after I raised this issue with my officials in June, I had dissenting views in the ministries where people felt still, as late as August, that there were no safety concerns. It was not until the destructive testing, which I ordered, quite frankly and quite assertively, in late August, that they were convinced. And you've heard their testimony, and if you look at all the paper, you'll know that. And Mr. Speaker, both you and I have worked, the member opposite, have worked in universities. We know the importance of searching for the truth and getting accurate information, and not, I hope, when we get into politics, losing the rigor of that review and evaluation. I am quite happy to provide you with any documentations, but
answer.
I will tell you there was not even consensus that there was a safety problem until the last week of August.
Thank you. New question, the member from Ottawa South.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Tourism, Culture and Sport. Minister, in the coming months, from May to October, communities will open doors of some of Ontario's most intriguing and charming heritage sites as part of a great program called Doors Open Ontario. This provides all Ontarians with a chance to visit many of the heritage sites and heritage homes in our province. Mr. Speaker, there are many sites in my hometown of Ottawa to visit, especially the Billings Estate National Historic Site in my riding of Ottawa South. Doors Open Ontario was a great initiative of the Ontario Heritage Trust, as it's important to remember our past to appreciate the present. Yes. Mr. Speaker, through you to the minister, can you please tell us more about the Doors Open Ontario?
Great question.
Thank you, Minister of Tourism, Culture, Sport.
Thank you, Speaker. I want to thank the member from Ottawa South for asking the question. He's a passionate protector of our heritage, and I want to thank him for that. Speaker, in 2002, Ontario Heritage Trust launched Door Open Ontario, the first province-wide event of its kind in our country. The last 12 years, great success, Speaker. Over 5 million visits have been made to heritage sites participating in this exciting initiative. It has grown to over 55 events in 170 communities, with over 1,200 sites and 500,000 annual visits as of last year. And it will keep growing, Speaker. Residents and visitors are invited to discover firsthand our province's hidden heritage treasures, some of which
Answer.
Have never been opened to the public. And best of all, admission is free, Speaker.
Yay. Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Minister, for that response. The Ontario Heritage Trust's efforts to organize and support such a wonderful program for all Ontarians to participate in is commendable. In fact, through Doors Open Ontario, visitors will learn that the Billings Estate in my riding of Ottawa South is Ottawa's oldest wood frame house and was built between 1827 and 1829. Mr. Speaker, the Ontario Heritage Trust's most recognizable symbol is its blue and gold plaque, or the blue and gold plaques that have been unveiled at over 1,200 sites in our province that tells the stories of the people, places and events that help shape Ontario. Mr. Speaker, again through you to the Minister, could he please tell us about the important work the Ontario Heritage Trust engages in?
Thank you, Minister.
Speaker, thank you for the question again. Speaker, since 2003, Our government has invested $74 million to the Ontario Heritage Trust to support and protect heritage across the province. Some of the other programs include the Provincial Register Program, which over 6,300 bylaws and 15,000 properties enter from heritage conservation districts. Speaker, Trails Open Ontario, which provide province-wide profile for 48 partner organizations and opportunities for the public to explore trails during 56 events in 54 communities. And to coincide with the World Woman Centennial this year, Speaker, on February the 14th, we launched Ontario Heritage Week at CMT Bolton. Speaker, lest we forget. Thank you.
Thank you. New question, the member from Burlington.
Acting Premier, last week the Ontario PC Party learned that Patrick Dillon of the Working Families Coalition is preparing a lawsuit against Her Majesty's loyal opposition for alleged defamation. That letter coincides with your action against our party leader, Tim Hudak, and the member from Nepean Carlton. Working Families spends millions of union dollars on personal attacks and misrepresenting our party's policies. Isn't this just another example of Working Families, a well-connected special interest group, working hand in glove with the Liberal government to silence the opposition?
Relevance.
What does that have to do with
us? Yeah, where is the government?
I would ask the member, I'd like to provide the member with an opportunity to tie that into government policy or to maybe reword that so that the government can answer a question that's based on...
Excuse me? I'm quite concerned with the personal conversations that are going on while I'm trying to do a ruling. I would ask, and I don't need the Minister of Aboriginal Affairs injecting his own wisdom anytime. And while it's not considered unparliamentary, it sure is disrespectful. I'll give you an opportunity to fix that question, please.
So I'll retract with Patrick Dillon was appointed by your government to the Ontario College of Trades and multiple agencies.
It counts.
Order, please. That's not the depth of the question. The question is about a lawsuit. The question is about that circumstance. I'd like you to see if you can either do that. If not, you'll have to redirect. Try again.
How many agencies does Patrick Dillon sit on?
Good question.
That's appropriate. Acting Deputy Premier.
Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities.
The Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities.
Well, that's an interesting question. How many agencies does Pat Dillon sit on? Mr. Speaker, I know he sits on the referral board for the College of Trades, Mr. Speaker. And, you know, I think that Ontarians get tired when politicians start raising individuals in their
house
when they're not in a position, Mr. Speaker, to be able to defend.
Order. The member from Simcoe North, come to order, please. And I don't need assistance on this side. Finish, please.
Mr. Speaker, if my memory serves me right, as I recall, the first people to appoint Pat Dillon to anything around here was the PC Party. So,
answer.
Mr. Speaker, it's unfortunate. when people dedicate their lives to public service, Mr. Speaker, when people dedicate their lives to serving on boards and committees, they really deserve better than that, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Didn't answer the question. How many? Acting Premier. Orange might have created untold sufferings and wasted billions if the member from Newmarket Aurora hadn't doggedly entered truths that you want to bury. Today, Orange is the subject of an OPP investigation. Taxpayers might have believed the Liberals' $40 million estimated cost to cancel two gas plants had the member from North Bay not demanded an accurate account. Today, was $1.1 billion. Your government's evasions have led to a second OPP investigation. Our questions are serious. These lawsuits are frivolous. What makes you think the courts will back your schemes to silence opposition's critics and stop us from telling the truth?
Good question. Be
seated, please. Given the circumstances that we were faced, I think I'm going to allow that question to be asked as a question of government, whether or not they believe that what they're... the member from Nepean Carleton is very close. So I'm going to allow that to happen. So the Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities.
Well, Mr. Speaker, asking a question about health care in a supplementary to a question that involves something completely different kind of puts a minister at a bit of a disadvantage because I'm not the Minister of Health Care. But, Mr. Speaker, I'll respond to this very curtly and very shortly, Mr. Speaker, referring to the first question. It's very easy, Mr. Speaker. People don't have to worry about others, whether anywhere, being concerned about lawsuits, Mr. Speaker, if they simply tell the truth.
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Transportation and Infrastructure. Despite the fact that bi-weekly meetings were occurring on the girder issue from December 2012 onwards within his minister's office that included his minister's political staff, his chief of staff, the deputy minister, deputy minister's staff, within minutes and with minutes forwarded to the premier's office. And despite the fact that a decision was made in the minister's own office on February 14th not to take action on safety issues surrounding these girders. Is the minister telling this legislature that not one single member of his political staff briefed the minister or sought guidance from the minister on this public safety issue, the biggest infrastructure project the minister was responsible for?
Thank you, Minister of Infrastructure and Transportation.
Yes, that's exactly what I'm saying, and that's exactly the truth, Mr. Speaker. And I'm going to be very clear about this. There have been discussions about every single project ongoing. There was no discussions at all with me, and when I asked my deputy in early June that there had been any issues with the girders requiring safety or concern, there wasn't. When I did become aware of it, I took extremely strong action, including an independent review, hiring independent legal counsel, and a matter of fact, much of that work going on with the review of those events still continues on looking at how to improve oversight on projects, and this government will be advancing ways to do that, Mr. Speaker. The public safety concern is always number one. That's why we paneled the leading engineers in the country. That's why we did an independent review. That's why there were two studies that were done.
Thank you.
And the government acted once it understood the situation.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Is it true that the Minister of Transportation and Infrastructure tried to quietly sweep the issue under the carpet and allow substandard girders to be installed and only to stop the installation when the Windsor Star was going to expose the safety concerns?
Minister?
Okay.
Sweep away. Sweep away.
I think it would be easier if I answered in French because she didn't seem to understand in English. See, it's been 2 weeks and there was no safety concern about these girders.
they were not about the safety of the girders. There is such a public inquiry. Two supplementary reports. There is more paper on this. No, prior to June, there were no discussions in my office relating to safety of girders. There were many discussions about girders biweekly because it's a big project and it would be pretty hard to go through years
answer.
Not talking about the project, Mr. Speaker. Mais enfin, j'espère que je parle français, c'est plus clair.
And I believe if I say it in French, it will be clear for you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Citizenship and Immigration. Ontario has more than 50,000 not-for-profit organizations that deliver vital services and help build prosperous and vibrant communities. In my riding of Scarborough Agincourt Community Service Association is a not-for-profit organization that provides quality services for children, youth, homeless and newcomer Canadians. And our NOAA government recognized contribution of the Ontario not-for-profit sector. And our government and the not-for-profit sectors share similar goals. Speaker, over the past few years, our government has launched several initiatives to build better understanding the government in terms of strengthening the relationship with this sector. Speaker, through you to the Minister, can he please share with the House the information about the volunteer strategy consultation, what is the goal, and who is participating?
Thank you, and I'd like to thank the hard-working member from Scarborough Agincourt for that excellent question. I really enjoy this aspect of the ministry because I get to see what Ontarians can do at their best. The not-for-profit sector is filled with individuals who embody true active citizenship. In 2011, our government released the Partnership Project Report. It included six key recommendations to create a stronger relationship between the not-for-profit sector and government. And in this spirit, we've launched the Ontario Volunteer Strategy Consultations. Consultations have taken place in Ajax, Thunder Bay, Mississauga, Ottawa, Markham, London, and Toronto. Consultation participants were not only from the not-for-profit sector, but also from the private sector and also from education. We spoke to other ministries in other provinces. In fact, we consulted with other countries. Mr. Speaker, we know that the not-for-profit sector here in this province are filled with individuals
who
invest their time, energy, and skill, and we are proud of our not-for-profit volunteers here in Ontario.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. I want to thank the Minister for his response and for helping to build an important social infrastructure in our province. Through the 2010 Partnership Project Roundtable discussions, almost all of the nonprofit participants told us they often had some difficulty accessing relevant government information. This information is important for their operations, administration, and annual charitable status reporting. I also know that not-for-profit needs information that is easy available and comprehensive when it comes to government programs, resources, and funding opportunities. Speaker, I know the Minister has been working very hard and passionately over the past year on this file. Speaker, through you to the Minister, can he please tell the House more about the initiative that our government has undertaken to support the not-for-profit sector in Ontario?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And again, I'd like to thank the member for that great question. And I do have some great news. Along with partners in Service Ontario, we're putting final touches on an online channel for not-for-profit sector that will provide easy access information on funding, regulations, and legal information.
Good idea.
And I had a great time earlier this month taking part in the launch of the province's PAN and Para-Pan-Am Volunteer Legacy. We've created a certificate program that recognizes skills acquired through volunteer placement as well as first-stop gateway for volunteers looking for opportunities in the Games. Additionally, we're working with other ministries to find ways to reduce the administrative burden and ensure the government initiatives consider the business needs for the not-for-profit sector. For example, we are participating in the government's Open for Business strategy in the not-for-profit sector and various ministries to find ways to simplify the transfer payment process for the not-for-profit agencies. Mr. Speaker,
answer.
Our government prioritizes what's most important to our citizens. The right to the best health care and education, but we also know that we have to make investments in the not-for-profit sector
Thank
and social
you.
Enterprise, and we're proud of the work we're doing on this side of the House, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question, the member from Lambton, Kent, Middlesex.
Thank you very much, Speaker. My question this morning is to the Acting Premier. Acting Premier, over the weekend, Ontario residents learned that your government gave the Registered Nurses Association of Ontario, the Registered Practical Nurses Association of Ontario, and Working Families Coalition Member Union, the Ontario Nurses Association,
$40 million, supposedly, to assist nurses your government is firing, get retrained, and find new employment. This money was given using an extremely unorthodox trust arrangement, which allows two of the nursing groups to keep any unspent money. In other words, you created an incentive for them to not spend this money on frontline nurses and minister they didn't. In fact, they only spent $236,000 on frontline nursing jobs, but racked up $6 million in expenses.
Whoa.
Acting Premier, what are you doing right now to get the $40 million back to the people of this province?
You seated, please. Thank you. The member from Halton will withdraw.
Withdraw.
Deputy Premier.
Thank you, Speaker, and I appreciate the opportunity to respond to that allegation, Speaker. I think it's important to remember where we were back in 2005, Speaker. We were nurses, 6,000 nurses had been fired by the previous government, and in fact, their plan is to do the same again if they have that chance. The nursing workforce was unstable, and I think we would all agree that there was an instability there that was resulting in nurses leaving Ontario. There were hospitals were running massive deficits. They were projecting that they would need to lay off 750 nurses. This fund was created, and it is a protected fund. That money must be used to retrain nurses who are moving from one area of specialty to another. That fund is protected.
Yes, sir.
It turns out that the need that was at that time expected to be used within a year, Speaker, turns out that need was not there because of changes we have made. I'll speak
Thank
more
you.
On the supplementary.
Supplementary.
Well, Acting Premier, the most generous possible interpretation of the Nursing Retention Fund boondoggle is that the RNAO, RPNAO, and ONA are utterly incompetent project managers and cannot be trusted to serve as stewards of taxpayer money. Deputy Premier, according to Public Accounts, Volume 3 from 2012 to 2013, the RNAO and RPNAO received over $18 million of taxpayer money combined, ostensibly to run various programs. Given their terrible performance with the Nursing Retention Fund, Acting Premier, will your government immediately freeze the flow of taxpayers' money to the RNAO and RPNAO in order immediate value for money audits of all these programs?
If anyone had any doubt that the attack on nurses would continue, that doubt is now erased. I think it's outrageous that the party opposite would attack those people who are on the front lines of our health care system, caring for the people in our system, Speaker. Just to be clear on the Nursing Retention Fund, Speaker, I have met with the Management Committee. I have asked them to come back. I've met with them in January. They have until the end of May to come back with an idea, Speaker, on how that money can be used to support the transformation in our health care system that is now underway. On this side of the House, we value our nurses. We understand we are in a time of transition. That's a difficult transition. We are there to support our nurses as we move, Speaker, from acute care hospitals into the community.
Another question? The member from Beaches East York.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Infrastructure. According to the Premier's own press release during the Liberal leadership race, she bragged that as Minister of Transportation, she oversaw the construction of the Windsor-Essex Parkway. The current minister in July wrote of the agreement negotiated, and I quote you directly from your own writing, "We may have compromised our ability to enforce the law by negotiating our authority away." Oops. End of quote.
Wow.
Why did the minister fail to act when he knew that he was compromising public safety on the Herb Gray Parkway by negotiating away any kind of authority you had?
Question. Thank you. Minister of Infrastructure and Transportation.
So, Mr. Speaker, I'm going to read very slowly again from the note the one piece of paper that the members opposite didn't want to have the public see. Minister's office staff were first briefed on the safety and durability issues regarding girders on the Herb Gray Parkway on June 14, 2013, and the minister was briefed on June 19, 2013. This is a piece of paper written in the file by officials, independent of any politician or minister, to make it very clear that all the other references to the Herb Gray Parkway were not discussions about the girders. Now, I know that fact is unpleasant and uncomfortable for the third party, but it is a fact that is really pretty hard to discuss. Mr. Speaker, as we went through over the summer the review, and we looked at who was overseeing this project, a lot of decisions were made that caused me concern, which led me to the independent
review,
including the negotiation of the project agreement, Mr. Speaker, and that is all well documented, but that is all long after June, Mr.
Thank
Speaker.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wow. Supplementary.
This minister wrote, and I quote you again, "We may have compromised our ability to enforce the law by negotiating our authority away." You wrote that yourself. Documents released through the Freedom of Information repeatedly show the Ministry of Transportation being critical of the project agreement because it does not allow the MTO to exercise its role and responsibilities as the legislated road authority and puts the public interest at risk. Why did the minister hide the fact he knew that the project agreement on the Herb Gray Parkway put the safety of people in this province at risk?
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, there is a review going on right now, as you probably know, of the AFP process, because we've discussed this before, on how we can prove it, and because it's a new and innovative project, and when you do a new and innovative thing, you review them. Mr. Speaker, there is a dispute resolution process in there. It was something that I have commented on the entire time I was minister. That is a full stop. It is not relating to the issues that the member is confusing it with. I first raised this issue in early June with my deputy. My deputy said very clear to me, no specific issues had been raised around the girder safety with her. I went to the Deputy of Infrastructure. I asked the same question. He told me the same thing. I asked them to review. June 19th, I got a briefing based on that review. They looked into it and they discovered the same issues that the member is now making reference to. I think that's clear, Mr. Speaker. J'espère que c'est pas nécessaire répéter en français.
I hope I won't have to repeat this in French again, but I hope this will be clearer in French. Thank you.
Your question, the member from Scarborough-Gilwood.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Government Services. Speaker, every member in this House knows how donations make a big difference. Ontarians contribute generously to a variety of causes. Their donations can do anything from feeding an empty stomach to saving a life. Without the thoughtful contributions of countless Ontarians, so many would do without. I've seen this generosity extended in my riding of Scarborough-Gilwood. As a province, we do our best to help those in need and to extend that help as far as our reach can go, including the global community. I understand that the Government of Ontario recently donated firefighting equipment to the Dominican Republic. Speaker, will the minister inform this House and residents in my riding about this important initiative?
Thank you. Minister of Government Services.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank the member for the question. Mr. Speaker, it was through a surplus assets distribution program at Ontario Shared Services, the Ontario government was able to donate surplus firefighting equipment to the Dominican Republic.
Good.
Ontario Shared Services first received a request from Firefighters Without Borders Canada in January. This is a registered charity whose goal is to assist emergency services worldwide. Working with Firefighters Without Borders Canada, Ontario Shared Services identified about 270 coats, 282 pants, 46 boots, and 42 helmets that will be donated to the Dominican Republic to help fight fires. fires. These items come from the Ministry of Community Safety and Correctional Services, Fire Protection Services in Thunder Bay. Firefighters Without Borders Canada is in the process of shipping them to the Dominican Republic.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you very much, Speaker, and thank you to the Minister of Government Services for that helpful update. I commend the Minister and the government for their generosity, and Firefighters Without Borders Canada for all the great work they do around the world. The Ontario government's commitment to helping its neighbours around the world is admirable, as is the active role Ontario plays in the global community supporting those in need. Here at home, we appreciate the hard work of the Toronto Firefighter Services in Scarborough-Guildwood. Stations 231 and 234 are in my riding, providing comfort and security to our residents. So I know that this donation of firefighting equipment will help save the lives of Dominican firefighters and the people they protect. Speaker, I have heard that similar donations to countries around the world. It is wonderful. It's a wonderful way to help
people in
need. Minister, have other provinces in Canada made similar donations?
Thank you. Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I'm pleased to say that Ontario is not the only province to donate firefighting goods to countries in need. Through partnerships with Firefighters Without Borders Canada, New Brunswick has donated approximately 60 sets of firefighting gear to date. British Columbia has donated 8 pallets of firefighting gear, and Quebec has 2 departments that are also making donations. We certainly recognize, Mr. Speaker, here in Ontario, the great impact of such generosity, and know that by combining with other provinces, our impact can be even greater. Programs such as this exist so that surplus assets are not thrown away when others can make use of them. Recognizing the needs of others, such as the Dominican Republic, can help save lives. Mr. Speaker, we are proud to help the Dominican Republic, and we are grateful for our partnership with Firefighters Without Borders Canada.
Answer. Thank you. New question. The member from Northumberland, Minty West.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Education. The Northumberland Child Development Centre has operated in my riding for over 2 decades and has always had an excellent record of service and care. They have built trusting relationships with the families they serve and have helped the children they work with take great strides in becoming valued members in our community. These relationships are vital to the development of these individuals, and jeopardizing those established relationships would be hugely detrimental to their progress. Minister, would you agree with this?
Minister of Education.
Yes, thank you very much. And one of the things that we do to help support child care, and I take it that this is a related to a child care question, but one of the things that we do to help support special needs children in child care is to provide funding for special needs resourcing. But the funding for special needs resourcing is actually managed by the local service manager, because in fact money for child care flows not directly from the Ministry of Education to the child care operator. It flows from the Ministry of Education to the municipal service manager, and it's actually the municipal service manager that makes all decisions about which agency provides various services.
Supplementary.
Well, back to the minister. This government can waste billions of dollars on gas plant scandals, Orange, and e-health that has led to several OPP investigations. But when it comes to the reallocation of funds, your government has attacked our most vulnerable. The NCDC's integrated funding model formally allocated $1.6 million for roughly 500 children receiving child care services in Northumberland. This plan was supported by the Ministry of Children and Youth Services for years. After the transfer to your ministry, though, the integrated model has been done away with. Now, $1.3 million will be going to fund roughly 100 children in child care, with only $167,000 left to service almost 450 remaining children. Since your ministry took over, 90% of the funding is now servicing only 20% of our most vulnerable. This is Liberalnomics at its worst. Minister, will you finally get a handle on the development services portfolio, step in, and reallocate the...
Thank you. Thank you. Minister of Education.
Yes, thank you very much. And one of the things actually that has happened since the child care came to the Ministry of Education is that we actually have been working quite extensively on modernizing that file. Now, part of that has been the transition to all of our 4- and 5-year-olds being in full day kindergarten, but we've also been working with our municipal service managers to modernize the whole child care sector. Part of that has actually been putting, for the first time ever, an actual funding model in place. Previous to this portfolio coming to the Minister of Education, there actually wasn't a formal funding model. We now have a funding model, but there has been significant transitional funding allocated to each of the service managers.
Thank you. There being no deferred votes, this House stands recessed. I'm in the process of dismissal. I'm sorry we didn't have a chance to get a hold of it. Okay, this afternoon. Thank you. This House stands recessed until 1 p.m. this afternoon.